Hello, greetings, and welcome. I'm Brien Posey, and recently somebody sent me an email and asked me a really interesting question about a video that I created a few months ago. That video, which you can see on screen, is all about using a utility called PS2EXE to turn a PowerShell script into an executable file. It's really easy to do, and if you haven't checked out this video, I would encourage you to do that. Now, the question that I was asked was with regard to external dependencies. So let's say, for example, that a PowerShell script references an external file. What do you do in a situation like that if you're trying to turn that PowerShell script into an executable? Well, one of the things that you can do is you can continue to allow that executable to reference the outside file. But the problem with that is that if you're planning on distributing the executable, then in that case, you have to think about what you can do to guarantee that the dependency files are going to remain in place. Typically, this is going to mean coming up with some sort of installation package so that when you deploy the script, all of the dependencies are installed. Now, another thing that you can do, and you probably can't do this for all file types, but you can do it for at least some, is to actually package the dependencies into the PowerShell script, which sounds a little bit weird, but it works out really well, and that's what I want to show you how to do in this video. So let's take a look. And here you can see that I've created several different PowerShell scripts, and one of those scripts is called depend.ps1. Now, the depend.ps1 script is just a basic PowerShell script that has an external dependency. Let me show you how this works. So right here, I have a file called logo.jpg. As you can see, this JPEG file is just the logo off of my website. So what I've done is I've created a PowerShell script called depend.ps1 that depends on this logo JPEG file. And you can see what the script looks like. And this is a really basic script. So what I'm doing in this script is I'm starting out by loading a couple of dependencies. And these are just some dependencies that are needed in order to create a GUI in PowerShell. The next thing that I'm doing is I've got a few lines of code that create what's known as a form. You can think of a form as being like a window. It essentially refers to the GUI interface itself. Then from there, I've got these two lines right here. The first one defines a variable called JPEG path, and I'm pointing the path to c:\script\portable\logo.jpg. That's the file that I showed you a moment ago. Then the line after that creates a variable called JPEG image. And I'm setting that image equal to system.drawing.image, and then I'm pulling it from the file that's defined in JPEG path. So in other words, the c:\script\portable\logo.jpg file. The next thing that I'm doing is I'm defining a picture box. And in a PowerShell GUI environment, a picture box is used to display an image. In this case, we're displaying the JPEG file. So I'm defining the picture box right here, and that picture box is going to be a new .NET object of type system.windows.forms.picturebox. So I'm creating a picturebox object. From there, I'm setting the picturebox size equal to the size of the JPEG image. So the next thing that I'm doing is I'm adding the picturebox to the form that I've created. You can see that I'm referencing $form and then controls.add, so I'm adding something to the form. And what am I adding? I am adding the picturebox. And then the last thing that I'm doing is I'm setting picturebox.image to the JPEG image. So that's going to take that image file and display it within the picture box. And then the last line of code just displays the dialog box on the screen. So let's take a look at what this looks like. And let me open up PowerShell, and I'm going to run depend.ps1. And you can see what the script does. It just displays a basic window with my logo in it. And so now I want to go back to the original question that I posed. Let's say that I've got this PowerShell script and I want to turn it into an executable, but I really don't want to have to deal with external dependencies, in this case, the logo file. How would I incorporate that logo file into the PowerShell script? The first thing that we need to do is we need to convert that logo file into a base64 encoded text string. And you'll notice that I've got a script called conversion.ps1. So my conversion.ps1 script really has two commands. The first one creates a variable called $base64image, and I'm setting that equal to convert to base64 string, and then we're reading all bytes of c:\script\portable\logo.jpg. So I'm reading the logo.jpg file, and I'm taking all of the bytes in that file, and I'm converting it into a base64 image. Then, the next thing that I'm doing is I'm writing that base64 image out to a file, and that file is going to be called c:\script/portable/logo.txt. So essentially what I'm doing is I'm creating a text string based on the contents of my logo file, and then I'm outputting that to a text file. So let's go ahead and run the script. And when I run the script, watch File Explorer in the background. You'll see a new file created. So I've run my script. There's no visible output, but you'll notice that now we have logo.txt. And if I open up logo.txt, you can see what my image file looks like now that it's been converted to Base64 format. And this is a lot to take in. So what we're actually going to be doing is incorporating this into our PowerShell script. Now, how do we do that? Well, let me go ahead and close this out and I'll show you. I've got two other script files here. I've got one called portable.ps1. This is a script in which I've already incorporated the text file, but because this text file is a lot to take in, I want to start by showing you a file called emptyportable.ps1. It essentially contains the code that we're going to need without containing all of the Base64 encoded imagery that you saw just a moment ago within the text file. So here's my emptyportable.ps1 file. So the very first thing that we're doing in this file is adding the Base64 encoded image string. Now that string doesn't exist in this file because I was trying to keep things simple, but what you would normally do is take the contents of that text file and then you would paste it here in place of where it says your Base64 encoded string here. So you'll notice that we're creating a variable called $Base64Image, and this variable is going to be an array as designated by the @ symbol, and then we're going to paste in the contents of the text file. So then, after we've created that Base64 image variable, the next thing that we have to do is decode the Base64 encryption. So I've created a variable called $ImageBytes, and I'm setting that equal to convert from Base64 string. And what are we converting? We're converting the Base64 image, which is the variable that we declared right here. So now that we've converted the image into something usable, the next thing that we have to do is to create a memory stream. So a memory stream is actually a type of .NET object. You'll notice that I've set up a variable called $MemoryStream, and I'm setting that equal to new object, and that's of type system.io.memoryStream. So once we've created that memory stream, the next thing that we have to do is write the contents of the image bytes variable. That's the decoded Base64 image. We need to write that to the memory stream, and that's done by using this line right here. So you can see that we have memorystream.write, and what are we writing? We're writing image bytes. And then the next thing that we have to do is to use memorystream.seek. You can see that I'm referencing the $MemoryStream variable, and then I've appended .seek. And then we have 0, and then system.io.seekOrigin, and then :\begin. What this line of code does is it sets a pointer so that we're looking at the beginning of the memory stream. Now, if some of this memory stream stuff seems a bit foreign to you, you don't even have to worry about it. You can use these lines of code verbatim as they're written here without actually having to dig into anything that you see in these three lines. So then the next thing that I'm doing is I'm setting up a variable called JPEGImage. Now, if I can switch back to my original script for just a moment, you'll recall that this script also had a variable called $JPEGImage. And in that case, I was setting JPEGImage equal to system.drawing.image, and I'm reading that image from a file, and that file was defined by the JPEG path, and the JPEG path pointed to c:\script/portable/logo.jpg. So I'm doing things a little bit different in the other file. Here, I'm still using the $JPEGImage variable, and I'm still setting it equal to system.drawing.image, but rather than reading the image from a file, I'm reading the image from stream. And that stream is, of course, my memory stream that I've created. So then below that, there's a comment that says the code below was not modified. Actually, that's not entirely true, because in my original script, we had these two lines of code right here that define the JPEG path and the JPEG image. And I don't need those lines of code anymore. So you can see that those two lines of code do not exist in this section. Aside from that, I haven't made any changes. Everything here is just the same. So the only real difference is that we're reading our JPEG file from that memory stream instead of reading it from a file. So what does this look like when we put it all together? As I mentioned, I already created a file called portable.ps1 that incorporates the script that you just saw plus the logo.txt file. So let's take a look at what this looks like. So here's the portable.ps1 file. And as you can see, I'm setting my $Base64 image variable, and then I've just pasted the contents of that text file right here. And if I scroll down, you can see where that definition ends right here. And then everything that comes after that is exactly like what I just showed you in the other script. So let's go ahead and close this out. And let me switch over to PowerShell and let's run the script. So I'm going to type /portable.ps1. And I'll run the script. And you can see that my logo appears within the window. And this time I'm not referencing any outside files. Everything that I need is contained within that PowerShell script. So that way, if I were to use the PS2 EXE utility to convert the script into an executable, I don't have to worry about any external dependencies. Everything that I need is embedded in the script, and at that point, the executable file is fully portable. I can move it from machine to machine without having to worry about installing anything or making sure that any external dependencies are in place. So hopefully that's something that's going to be helpful to you. I'm Brien Posey. Thanks for watching.